Are you ready to take part in God's Omega Task? The first question should be, why the name the Omega Task? Well, the answer is a simple one. As believers, we should be longing for the return of Jesus Christ. Christ gave us one final task to complete before his return in Matthew 24:14. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. Right now, there are over 3.2 billion people in the world who have little to no knowledge of the gospel. Let that sink in. 3.2 billion people. They are plunging into a literal eternal hell, and no one has even told them how to get to heaven. I believe this means you really need a good reason to not be running to them. We should be running to them as if their very conversion depended on us. Because, in a very real sense, it does. That's Romans chapter 10. They will not hear if someone does not go. Yes, we can rest on God's divine sovereignty that he will accomplish this mission. But let's not forget the means in which he will accomplish this mission. It's you and me. It's our churches, our seminaries, our spirit-filled brothers and sisters running to them. Are we completing the Omega task, Christ's final task? Are we making disciples so that he will come back? Or do we love this world? Do we love our comforts? Do we love our things more than we want Jesus to return? Brothers and sisters, we invite you to join us, to partner with us as we work to extend the kingdom of God here on earth. Many have come to help us with building projects. They have helped with our kids' clubs. They've joined in as we work towards the goal of putting a Bible in every home in Costa Rica through Bible distribution. Many have encouraged the young ladies here through our prenatal ministry, and so much more. We invite you to come and visit us in Costa Rica, to be part of sharing the hope that's within us to a lost and dying world. I leave you with the words of the late Ann Judson, the wife of missionary Adoniram Judson, from a letter that she wrote back in the 1800s to their supporters. Oh, that the members of the Baptist Convention could live in Rangoon 1 month. Will the Christian world wake up? Oh Lord, send help. Our waiting eyes are unto thee.
I don't know if this is on. Looking forward to hearing from Ben. Ben, would you come up? And I'm sure he'll introduce his family as well. Would you help me in joining or welcoming Ben? I will just say this quick word, that this is a man who lives out the life of Jesus in Costa Rica. The hands and the feet of Jesus with anyone and everyone he comes into contact with. And so we praise God for this man and his ministry. He's touched my family when we've been down there. Our daughters have gone down twice and left such an impact on our family. And we love you all, and we're so glad you're here. Would you share with us a little bit about your family and your testimony and whatever God has laid on your heart?
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. See? Good. How wonderful to be here and to see so many familiar faces of people that came, and also get to enjoy the holy burning fire that abides in this place, the truth of the Word of God. We live in a very unique and important season, and for this wonderful season, the Lord calls to shine and shine brighter. And make no mistake, the truth of God will not be compromised. The truth of God might not be popular and accepted. The sovereignty of our God and His saving grace that He poured down to all of us is not going to be compromised. He's going to prevail, and His church, His holy church, not even the gates of hell will prevail against it. Celebration is a word that I have for you today. Celebrate. Celebrate that you found Jesus. Celebrate that you've been saved. And go out there and reach out the lost for Him. During the last 10 years, we've seen God answer prayers, support us, back us up, lift us up when we stumble with our own feet. We serve a gracious, loving, and caring God. And it is about to be 10 years, because next year we will celebrate 10 years of the Omega Task. And you all are part of this celebration. You all who had been praying, who had been giving, who had been going. And it is so wonderful to come here to Redding, to the state of California. And I'm here to tell you, California belongs to Christ. You are here to resist. You are here to occupy schools, businesses, churches, communities, projects. Never give up. We serve our Lord that put Himself in a cross for all. And He withstood the storm till the end. And then He rose again in victory. So we are here to celebrate this book, to celebrate the truth that He gave us to keep going in a world that is dark. But isn't it in the darkest place where His light will shine brighter and stronger? And as I heard today, Pastor Andrew preach, I was so encouraged, because the Holy Spirit gave him this question: who are we? Who are we, brothers and sisters? We are the children of God. We were brought from death to eternal life. We were brought from being enemies to be at the table of the Lord. And that's why we are so excited and so on fire. We need every nation to come to His knowledge. And this word says that as the waters cover the sea, every nation will be full and will come to the full knowledge of the glory of God. So we are here today to bring you a great report of all the things that God has been doing in Costa Rica. And this year is a milestone, because for the first time, the children that came to the kids club and were discipled through years and years are now starting college this year. You know, years ago, they didn't want to go to high school, or they didn't want to finish primary school. And you know, these children, now becoming young adults like the ones we were celebrating today, are going to become the first professionals in the history of their families. They are going to break down a cycle of poverty, and they are going to be disciple-making people that will become community leaders and that will proclaim the glory of God in the future. So we have the kids' clubs going on. The youth program grew to be like around 20 youngsters. We had a BBS with around 100 children. And little by little, the Lord has been answering prayers and being with us day after day after day and showing us the path of His joy. This joy that was given to us is not just for us to keep, but for us to go and bring to those that are lost and that need salvation. This is the love that Christ brought to us through His sacrifice, so we can go and tell them that they have a way, that there's hope for them. And we really need to ask ourselves, once again, who are we? What's our purpose? Why are we here today? How come we were born for this season, for this generation, and not 200 years ago? It is for today. It is for such season that the Lord called you. And this season, this time, is requiring, like the people we find in this book. When we pray with our children in Costa Rica, we always say, Lord Jesus, help us be what you want us to be. Maybe you are the Daniel that this season needs. Maybe you are the Moses that this generation needs. Maybe you are the Joseph California needs. The Ruth, the Esther. We serve the same God that delivered them. We serve the same almighty burning fire that abides at this place where His glory is proclaimed. So it shouldn't be different. We pray to an almighty God, and we should expect miracles to happen. Because the same Spirit that rose Jesus from His grave lives in us. So there's a lot of noise out there. There's a lot of propaganda, a lot of agendas going on there. This truth will stand. All that will come to an end. But His church will stand and prevail. So we can tell you that, for example, through Bible distribution, like you were seeing in the video, we went through the years to probably around 600 homes now. And we share a Bible with them, and we talk to them about Christ. Many of them came to the Lord. Many of them finally have a Bible that they can read. And when you come to their homes, you see that they were expecting you. Some of them said, I knew you were coming today. And I needed you to come today. So we need to remember that we have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit goes before us. And the Holy Spirit is the one who's going to bring conviction. Conviction of sin, conviction of justice, and conviction of judgment. And like Pastor Andrew was preaching today, maybe it's not a feel-good message. Maybe it's not a sugar-coated fluffy message. What do you prefer? Do you want to actually get to heaven all offended? Or get somewhere else really happy? We need the truth of God. And we are not to compromise such treasure, such gems like we were hearing today for a season that wants to convince us, oh, God will never do that. Oh, no, He is so good to do that. Well, with nice words like that, be sure that the truth of God, His message, what He wants for us, what He wants us to become in such season, has not to be traded for feel-good messages or for feel-good lies that lead to condemnation. That's why He brought us grace in abundant life to share with the lost. So in Costa Rica, we have the pregnancy center that maybe some of you heard about, that my wife runs. Many of the ladies came to the Lord. It is a program for when they know that they are going to have a baby, till when the baby is a year old. So it is a year and 9 months of discipleship for the women. Then we have the youth program, because the children grew. Some of them are now 17, 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, that, like I told you, are starting college. And we have a bunch that are in fifth grade of high school, and they are going to start college next year. And like you kids are going to face different challenges, but we pray that now they are rooted in the Word of God and His truth, and that they will live in celebration of who He is and who they are in Him, in what He has for them in this time and in the future in His glory. So we also have outreach to rural areas in the country, where we got to share with wonderful people that you saw, beautiful photography by the team that recently came. We are really blessed with the people that during the years came to visit us. Some of you came, some of you went several times, some of you I know will go back. And we are also praying for more volunteers, because as we grow, we need more hands, more people to come and join us and be the hands and feet of the Lord in Costa Rica. So we are really grateful today to bring a great report of all the things that God has been doing through the years, all the lives that had been transformed, all the promises that He had made, see a vision come to fruition. One of the projects that we are celebrating is the coffee house, which is a place where people that won't go to a church will come for a cup of coffee and will go back home with Jesus. Like I was telling you, we need to occupy. You know, the Bible clearly says that we are in this world, but we are not from this world. We need to remember where we came from and where we are going. And we need to be sure to continue the ministry that Jesus Christ started and be intentional. You know, is not a human philosophy. It's not a human strategy. It's not a human teaching or ideology. Be there for the lost. Do what Jesus did. It is as simple as go and make disciples. Go, love one another. It doesn't say that we need to celebrate what's wrong. It doesn't say that we need to celebrate lies and embrace them. It says that we need to be courageous and bold to share the truth exactly as it is, and not go with the spirit of this season, but go with the truth of God. So the coffee house became such a great tool for ministry. And we had church services there. We have Bible studies. We saw people come to the Lord. We prayed for people. People who opened their hearts through the help of the Holy Spirit. And then they will ask you, why did I tell you that? I didn't want to tell you that. Well, that's my private struggle. Why am I telling you this? But God is so loving and caring to bring to the coffee house the ones that need to hear a word of encouragement, even a word that may challenge them, because we live in such a rush. And we've been learning a lot about coffee. We even got certified as professional baristas. The Lord bless us with coffee that we are producing, that just He wanted to be specialty coffee. And we actually need to be 80 points to be specialty coffee. And God's grace gave us perfect note or grade in three subjects, and that rose to 85 points. So our coffee is not good or excellent. It's an extraordinary coffee. Amen. And all that shows the goodness of God. You know, it's been a journey where we understand that even though we are so passionate about coffee, and when I'm making coffee for people, there's one method that you will learn about that takes 5 minutes to make coffee. But people don't have 5 minutes, right? So it gives me the great opportunity to tell them things like, where are we going in such a rush? How come we don't have 5 minutes for one of the, you know, world's class coffees? Where are we going with such rush? And then I tell them 5 minutes. It's not an eternity. But in 5 minutes, we can talk about eternity. And there's when they wake up. And they say, well, I just wanted some coffee. This is getting quite serious. Now I need to ask myself, where am I going when I die? And I ask them, where are we all going in such rush? And some say, well, we all are going to die. And I ask them, where are you spending your eternity? And they will say things like, nobody knows. And I will tell them, really? I know where I'm going. Because it doesn't depend on me. It depends on Christ, who gave it all. So I can tell you today that He loves you, that He wants to give you a path directly to Him, to our relationship. This is far beyond, more important than coffee. Where are you spending eternity? And people then, well, if you say it that way, that makes sense. If it doesn't depend on me, It is about grace, I tell them. And then they are like, well, can I continue doing everything like I do? And I tell them, well, he receives you exactly how you are, to transform you, to change you, to give you purpose, to set you on fire for a purpose for the redemption of the nations, to transform your own family, to transform your community, to transform the ones that you are not talking to bring forgiveness into your life, to bring healing into your life. So we have opportunities at the coffee house to talk to atheist people that will look me in the eye and tell me, Ben, give me proof that God is real. And I will reply back, I'm seeing you, you are the proof. And next time that you look yourself in the mirror, know that Jesus loves you. Know that he gave his own life to rescue you. You are hearing me, right? You are seeing me, right? Do you think that's just a coincidence that all that happened? No. He created you in his likeness. And you know, there's a place down there in the heart of that atheist person that knows that there's a maker, a creator, and a sovereign father. People sometimes are just mad at God. And this is the problem of this generation. Because this generation doesn't want God to be God. They want to create their own version of a permissive God that thinks that everything is okay, and that we can celebrate everything, and that we all will go to heaven anyway. We have a free gift that came to us with a dearly price. It was given to us for free, but it was paid with the highest price of a lamb that was completely, completely innocent. But he stood there for us, and he gave it all. And now, thousands of years later, his payment stands tall, and it is available for all. It's been a wonderful journey to see God answer prayers, to see God give us wonderful family like CrossPointe Church, to see you there when you go, to see your emails when you send them, to be able to report to you that Christ is alive, in that he's not done with you or with me, that he's shaping you and me to become what he wants us to be. So this morning I want to encourage you to ask yourself that same question. Who are we? Why are we here? What does God want me to do? Not tomorrow. Today, what does he want me to change in my life? What can I do for my community? What can I do to break that boundary between having a conversation with somebody and sharing the gospel? The gospel of grace, the gospel of repentance, the gospel of the truth of Christ and why he paid what we couldn't pay. The Holy Lamb of God is calling us today to the celebration of being part of the divine plan of God, creator of heavens and earth, to redeem the darkest of places on this earth. That is the kind of power that I'm talking to you about today. In this generation, brothers and sisters, won't get a speech to convince them. This generation will get power from above that will ultimately win their hearts, because no one can resist when the love of God calls you and tells you there at the darkest place, you are mine. Who's going to change that? Who's going to change the will of God when His sovereign mouth says, you are mine? He reaches His hand to you and grabs you and shapes you and shakes you to be what He wants you to be. Who's going to change the sovereign words of the Almighty over you? Who's going to change that? Who's going to twist the arm of God to prevent the Almighty from fulfilling the will of His heart in your life? A long time ago, I decided to surrender. I couldn't procrastinate it a minute. In that day, when I gave up, when I brought my silly dreams to the Lord, and I told Him, Lord, pay attention. I said, Lord, here you have my dreams. You better see what you do with them. You better trade them for something better. And He answered, you don't know who you are talking to. Brothers and sisters, all my dreams came to fruition, and they were traded for the joy and the glory of seeing God call people from darkness and transform them to be for His glory. There's a time when we wake up and understand that there's no better place to be but in those tracks that are called the will of God. There's no dream that you can have yourself that's greater than the dreams He will fulfill in your life. And that's what we've seen at the Omega Task. That's why, you know, people sometimes ask me, Ben, why do you do what you do? And I tell them honestly, there's nothing better I can do with my life. There's nothing more important, more glorious, more full of joy, grace, love, peace, fulfillment that I could do. So this morning, I want to encourage you to get more involved at CrossPointe Church, to be more equipped, to pray more, to worship more, and to take Redding down for Christ. And never compromise the truth of God with false teachings. That's like a candy. You'll feel good for a moment, then it will be very, very bitter. The truth of God may be when He brings you to your knees and convinces you of how much you need repentance and how much you need forgiveness. And maybe it feels a little bitter at the moment, but then you will enjoy the sweetness of a true and rooted relationship with the Savior. So make no mistake. Don't trade this truth for those candies that are floating out there and are popular, because they won't take you to the real thing. You know, we want the real thing. We want Jesus. So through this year, we are bringing a report to our friends and families and let them know that we are in awe of all the different ministries that are happening in Costa Rica. And we have prayer points for you. We are praying for more volunteers. So pray about it. Pray about coming to Costa Rica and learning Spanish. Pray about coming to Costa Rica and learning skill. Maybe becoming a certified barista, but for sure, be a certified follower of Christ and go and be His hands and be His feet and celebrate the joy of the Lord in your life and in the lives of others. So this year, we are traveling after 2 years of not traveling, not coming here. We are really blessed. Had the opportunity to be here today and share with you a great report. So the missions house, we are doing, you know, repairs, getting it better, getting it, you know, more ready for teams to come. And we also have 2 terraces that we are developing, and we would like to build some, you know, casitas. So when you come and visit us, then let's say you are a married couple, or you have a baby, or you have children, so you have your privacy. We realize through the years that, you know, when you come, maybe you don't want to be separated in groups, and sometimes some people need their own space. So we would like to build four little casitas, so people can come and volunteers can have space, or families that need room and privacy. So we are going to be having some building projects that you can prayerfully consider about supporting, so we can build those structures. And we are really excited to also tell you that we continue to support the education of children in our community, and that more and more and more kids keep coming to our kids' clubs. Like you remember, now we have a van, and we use this vehicle to go and pick up the children, and then we drop them home, we drive in a loop, and more kids are coming to our programs. And this morning, we just want to give you a big thank you. Thank you for coming this morning. Thank you for staying afterwards. You all are such an encouragement to us. And we are looking forward to sharing more with you. We want to encourage you to subscribe yourselves to our website, theomegatask.com. where you can get our newsletters. And if we can have maybe one member of the church, if any of you need help to get subscribed there, maybe somebody can help us be sure that people are getting our newsletters, because we would like you to be receiving the reports of what God is doing in Costa Rica. So, just let me close with this. And we've been studying in Costa Rica about the transformation of the disciple. And as you may remember, Peter was a very, let's say, impulsive disciple, right? So he had to go through different seasons. And as you may know, the same Peter that denied Christ, or the same Peter that cut Malchus's ear, is not the same Peter that is talking here in Acts 3, verse 6. And you all remember this moment, historical moment, when Peter said, "I do not possess silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, walk." What do you have? What did you receive from the Lord? What are you going to give to others? The joy that you received, the grace that you received. You know, Peter had to go through such transformation. Pray for God to transform us, for God to transform me, to become what He really wants me to be. That I will fully understand that I need to grow. You know, this Peter that got, so impulsive and said things like, "I am going with you wherever you go. I will go to death with you." And then he was so fearful when we saw the moment coming. But I tell you this, Peter loved his Christ in a way that we all should love him. He got so excited. "Jesus, if that is you, command me to walk in the water." And he did. But he still needed transformation. Well, this Apostle Peter here is fully transformed now, and he has fire and power, and he knows who he is in Christ. And now he says, "Well, I don't have money to give you. I'll give you what I got." And everybody saw the glory of God. So this morning, I want to encourage you to ask yourself, what does Jesus still need to transform in your life so you can be a fully transformed disciple? And I know, even the Apostle Paul, like we were studying one of his letters today, he said, "It's not that I accomplished it. I press on." So continue. Continue to press on. This morning, we just want to express our gratitude to you all. Because it takes a team to fulfill a dream. And all that God has done in Costa Rica couldn't be possible without you. You are part of this celebration, and we want to encourage you to continue to be part of all that God is doing in Costa Rica. And God wants to use you in Redding, and God wants to transform lives through you here in your community too. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we praise your name. And we want to bless your name here at your sanctuary, at CrossPointe Church. Thank you, Lord, for such beautiful, loving and caring family. Thank you, Lord, for Pastor Andrew, for Chaplain Jim, for all the people that are part of this ministry. I pray, dear Lord, that you will bring new anointment upon them, new conviction through the Holy Spirit to continue to extend your kingdom in this community and among the different ministries that they run. We praise your name at this place, and we proclaim that California belongs to Christ, that the government of the United States belongs to Christ, that the mayors and Senate members are full of your fear and come to repentance. We want to proclaim your glory upon California. And we want to thank you, Lord, because I grew up singing hymns that were translations of the hymns that the U.S. missionaries brought to Costa Rica. I'm now a missionary because they had the courage to go and bless my nation. So I come back today and proclaim that same glory and cry out before you for your Holy Spirit to come upon California in such mighty way. The revivals will break out everywhere. This nation, Lord, honor you, bringing your word to every corner of the earth. And today we humbly cry out to you for mercy, for your favor, and for your blessing upon your children, the children of God, that they will extend your kingdom and that they will see your glory in such season like the one we are living in. I thank you, Lord, for CrossPointe Church and for the opportunity you gave us today to share with them about the family they have in Costa Rica and all the mighty things that you are doing there. I pray, Lord, that you will continue to bless every family represented here at this place, and that you will answer their prayers as they press on to grow in a deeper and deeper relationship with you, Lord Jesus. We pray in your name, and we all together say, amen.
Amen.
Father, we continue in prayer and just... He's asked us to do so, our brother Ben. We pray your grace for him and his family. Lord, it was such a blessing to just sit and glean from this man's passion for your gospel, your word, your work in Costa Rica. God, the challenge that we use whatever you've gifted us with right here, right now, to share the gospel. Lord, for Ben and Taja, it's been the coffee connection. God, the coffee fields that our brother Ben here grew up in, picking these all of this coffee and then seeing it happen. Lord, now returning there and just pouring into these people's lives, showing them Jesus, using the coffee house there, the restaurant there, the cafe there, the buildings there that you've given them, all of them for one purpose, and that is to share Jesus with people in that community. Thank you for the church that meets there. Thank you for these young ones that are being touched. And we pray for them. Lord, I pray for Ben. Uphold him by your grace. I pray for Taja. Uphold her by your grace. Bless Josiah. Bless Estella. Keep them safe. Keep them healthy. Give them many years of fruit, and let us know, let us be reminded constantly to pray for them. Lord, thank you that they are taking the context of life that you've put them in and shining the light of Jesus brightly in this dark world. Thank you for the encouragement it was to us here today. Please continue to provide for their needs, God, particularly with these casitas that need to be built. Bless them and provide for those. Lord, as we continue to fellowship and then go our ways, I pray that you bless the remainder of our time. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you thank me? Would join me in thanking our brother for being with us today.